Welcome back to the Island 54 Devlog. Today, I'll add a server-controlled mob into the game. Last episode, I finished up most of my initial work getting my scalable server set up. There were still a lot of rough edges remaining, but I plan to gradually iron those issues out as I continue working towards a combat system. So in this episode, I'm adding a fantasy monster into the game. It's not going to have any functionality yet, because I've also been closing out a bunch of technical debt that's been taking up a bit of my time. I'll start by describing a few of the technical issues I resolved since last episode. Then I'll talk a bit about how I rationalise including a fantasy monster in a hyper-realistic game, and how I want my combat system to work. Lastly, I'll put a single persistent instance of a monster into my world. I want to firstly apologise for the delay between last episode and this one. I've had a number of things come up that needed my attention, but hope to be able to return to a more regular schedule now. I spent a lot of time paying down technical debt that's been building up over the last few episodes. For those unfamiliar with the term, technical debt is the concept that you almost always take shortcuts when developing software. Those shortcuts will usually save you a lot of time up front, but they can make it harder to further develop the software down the line. The extra development time is a bit like an interest payment, and sometimes feels like it's starting to compound, hence the term technical debt. Shortcuts effectively let you borrow time against future productivity. So it's worth taking a step back from time to time to clean up the hacky bits of code, or pay down your technical debt. Last episode, I pointed out an error that my server emits as it comes up. Matt W. pointed out on Discord that I could have used the depends on clause in Docker to stop my services from coming up out of order. This is a great tip, because while it didn't affect the functionality of the system, superfluous errors can make it harder to identify real errors. So I fixed that up, told Docker how to test that my services are healthy, and generally improved some other aspects of my development loop. I also wanted to fix my terrain generation. It was all a bit hacky at the end of last episode. To allow mobs to walk around, the server is going to need an accurate model of the terrain, so I figured I should at least dehackify my terrain code to work towards that. I had previously been trying to rewrite the terrain generation from scratch in TypeScript. I realized that was a waste of effort, since I already had a perfectly good implementation in C#. So I pulled up my existing coordinate and generation code in one window and ported it function by function across to TypeScript. It took no time at all to port across, and I literally only had one bug. The bug led to some nasty terrain, as you can see here. Based on the directionality of the bad terrain, I assumed I was using an X coordinate in place of a Z coordinate or something like that. But after writing some unit tests, it turned out to be a bug in my conversion from the hexmod representation I described in my hexagon and streaming episodes. The hexmod conversion function uses floor division, which is the default kind of integer division in most languages, like this example in Python. With floor division, 3 divided by 2 is just 1, with no remainder. TypeScript, on the other hand, has no concept of integers, so 3 divided by 2 is 1.5. To fix the test, I changed the code to explicitly floor the result of the division. The TypeScript simplex noise generator works a bit differently to the one I was using in Unity, so I had to retune the parameters. But the simplicity of the TypeScript implementation really shone here, making it easy for me to tune the generation just by modifying these two list parameters. I also varied the noise seed to find a good seed that had the world origin just above water level. And here's the terrain being generated by my server now. I still have some weird terrain drawing bugs where little fans of terrain sometimes poke up through the ground, but that's been there at least since I implemented my hex tiles. I'll sort that out some other time. I may end up porting the height map to mesh code across to the server at some point too, so that clients don't need to do the calculation on every chunk, and that would be a perfect opportunity to fix this bug. I also fixed an annoying bug that's been hanging around since I implemented chunk streaming. The player spawn code sometimes tries to place the player before the spawn chunk has been loaded and its mesh generated, causing the player to fall through the floor. This is worse when the terrain is controlled by the server, since there's added latency in talking to the server. In time, I'll have the client preload important pieces of terrain, but this is still an issue that needs to be addressed. When I spawn the player in, I now check if the spawn chunk mesh has been generated. If not, then I listen for a new chunk render event, waiting for the correct chunk to be rendered, at which point we can safely spawn the player in without them falling through the floor. This code could be improved. For example, I probably want to make sure the spawn chunk is in the load queue, otherwise it may never get loaded. My first aggressive mob is going to be a troll. A lot of people will find that to be a strange choice, given my push for hyper-realism in my game. I thought I should probably explain how I rationalise that. It's the game mechanics that I want to be hyper-realistic. While I want the world to be grounded in realism, I also want it to be fantastical, with just a little suspension of disbelief. Is it conceivable that a land inhabited by a scattering of humans and no trace of the civilization we know and love might be inhabited by semi-intelligent humanoid creatures? As long as the trolls aren't literally turning people to stone, I have no problem with that. In time, I'd like to turn this land into something a bit more alien. Instead of chickens, I want some kind of fictional bird that fills a similar niche within the world. It would lay edible eggs and be hunted or farmed for meat. For now, it's easiest just to use chickens. Rather than trolls, I want to devise a set of semi-intelligent humanoids that inhabit the land. While I could make them goblins, kobolds, orcs, ogres, and trolls, I'd rather they be something unique to my game. But for now, it's easiest just to start with a troll, because that's a model I already have access to. I don't want trolls to be the first thing a player runs across. I instead want the early stages of the game to be more like a real ecology, where players start fighting some sort of less intelligent wild animal. As they get deeper into the game, I want them to discover more and more fantastical elements of the world. And on that topic, I do fully intend to implement a magic system. But again, my idea for a magic system is not like you see in most games. My preferred system would depend on the idea that any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. I want as little suspension of disbelief as possible to make a magic system that's compelling. As for combat mechanics, I want it to be slightly more strategic than most games out there. I don't want it to be only about who can aim the best, and certainly not about who can click the fastest. A lot of games let you use your skills on a timer, so you aim your shot and swing your sword. If you have other resources at your disposal, maybe a shield strike, then maybe you can use that from time to time. But otherwise, you parry or retreat, waiting for your next opportunity to attack. What I'm going for is not quite turn-based, but I suppose that is the feel of the combat system I'm working towards at the moment. Just before I get into the actual implementation, I wanted to thank Unity for supporting this series and point out that they have a special deal for first-time customers, allowing you to get 25% off your first purchase through the Unity Asset Store by using code WELCOME2022 at checkout. Some conditions do apply, so follow my affiliate link in the description below for full details. Now, I know a lot of you are, like me, interested in procedural world generation, and there are dozens of procedural world assets at half price at the moment. Or even better, there's a procedural world asset bundle where you can save up to 94% off the total list price of the individual assets. With that out of the way, it was now time to put a troll into the world. I started by inserting a new entity into my entity manager. I needed to know where to spawn in the troll, so I called out to the terrain manager to get the land height at some arbitrary coordinate near the origin. With a debug parameter set to true, I can convert the result to a vector 3 that lines up with the ground pretty easily. I hadn't decided exactly what server-side components I was going to use to control mobs, so I just sort of made it up as I went along. I needed the client to know how to draw the mob, so I gave the mob component a model field and set it to troll. While I don't yet have a despawn system, I added a component to prevent this mob from naturally despawning when I do write that system. I set the location of the mob using the parameter I had pulled from the terrain server and dispatched the request with curl. Fetching all the entities, we can see the troll is now saved, even stopping the server and restarting it, and it's still there. Excellent. Running the client, we see what looks like another player being drawn where the troll should be. This is because the client currently assumes that all other server-side entities are players. It was time to fix that. I downloaded the troll that was included in the first Ukraine bundle. It took a little messing about to get it working, but with the materials converted over to URP and the demo scripts removed, since they depend on the old input system, I was able to drop a troll into my world. Now, before anyone panics, this is again, like the chickens, just a placeholder. It's easier for me to use a high-res asset than make my own asset that better fits the game. I'll get around to that another time. When the client sees an entity from the server, it stores a copy of all the server-side components that come back. What I needed was a conversion step that can look at those components and appropriately configure the client-side game object. There was no point in writing a general-purpose converter, since I still don't know what I want the server-side components to look like or how I want anything to behave, so I just wrote a really simple function. If there's a mob component and it has a model attribute set to troll, then it loads in the troll model. Otherwise, it treats it as a player capsule. This code doesn't allow the server to change the model once it's loaded into a client, but that doesn't seem like it's an unreasonable limitation at the moment. I'll address that if and when I need it with a more general purpose component conversion step. The server can change the position of the mob, which is more important to me now. So that's where I'm at now. I have a mob loaded in, which can be controlled by the server. As I mentioned in the community post after last episode, I'm hoping to move to a fortnightly release schedule for the Devlog for the time being. In the next episode, I plan to implement mob animation and attack. These will both be implemented in the server, with consequences directly visible in the client, including damage to the player. If you enjoyed this episode, don't forget to give it a thumbs up. If you didn't enjoy it, be sure not to subscribe so you can miss out on seeing me make progress on my combat system. If you want a recap of how I built my scalable game server, I covered it across 3 episodes, starting with episode 15. There's a card on the screen now. And as always, happy game developing.